you guys, what's up? It's me, MJ Fangirl, and in today's video, we're gonna be doing a reaction video to a really exciting Michael Jackson interview. This is his first major interview with a television personality from Australia, Molly Meldrum. I did do a reaction to a Molly Meldrum interview previously, and it was really, really a big hit. So I wanted to do this one because I've heard that this is like the most legendary interview, you guys. It's all about the Bad era, the Bad tour, going backstage with him, getting a look into his personal world. So stay tuned. You don't want to miss it. You are now watching MJ Fangirl TV. You guys, so before we get into today's video, if you guys don't know me, I am MJ Fangirl. I make videos for and about the Michael Jackson fan community right here on YouTube. I'm really excited to be doing this. I do all videos about Michael Jackson. I also do some other videos on Patreon. If you're interested, I just launched my Patreon. Those are videos for people that want to get to know me better, that want to chat with other MJ fans. Yes, there's a tier where you can get on a Zoom call with me and other MJ fans, as well as a tier for those of you who are creators and want some of my tips and tricks for YouTube. So without further ado, check out the Patreon if you're interested, and let's get into this reaction video.
Superstars, by definition, are rather unusual people. So when you get to the most super of superstars, you have to expect the kind of weird and wild rumors that surround Michael Jackson. We don't touch on the pop world all that often, but Michael Jackson is much more than an entertainer. He's a symbol of the times. He hasn't given a full-scale TV exclusive this decade. So when, in the whimsical manner of superstars, he chose Australia's Ian Molly Meldrum to do the first interview and us to present it, we thought, why not? It meant putting up with an army of minders and going through more complicated negotiations than an arms treaty. The result is a break from our normal format, but we think you'll find it quite a colourful piece. And with that, we turn you over to our guest reporter, Molly Meldrum.
All right. Backstage with Michael Jackson. As close to his private world as you could ever hope to get. People are always asking about the man behind the myth. But in this electric moment, is there really any difference?
Oh, I love this.
If you want to find out more about the real Michael Jackson, you start here at his magical launching pad and let yourself be part of the illusion.
Very reminiscent of the Victory Tour, you guys. But anyway. Different night. I love how Michael's like snapping with the beat. Like he's like all in with the music here.
A high voltage performance wired up to another world. The man they call Pop's Peter Pan is in full flight. If there was ever a pure entertainment machine, you're watching it.
With a body, yep, talking. Like, where is this footage, you guys? I want to see the entire night of this performance. Like, so good.
Watching him on stage and the power of his performance, I remember the shy kid I interviewed in New York for Countdown in 1977.
Do you regret having to pick up this girl with?
No, I enjoy it. I love to read and learn and all that stuff.
Yeah. Now, over in Australia, we've seen you on many of the big shows, like the big music awards and things like that.
Oh, yeah.
And your little sister's been on a
film. Oh, yeah.
She's a funky little sister.
She is funky.
She's amazing.
Even back then, he'd already come such a long way. The son of a plane driver from industrial America, tripping the life fantastic when his friends were struggling in school plays, the boy who was born to sing knew nothing but the stage. At the time I talked to him, he was getting ready to rock with you.
Yes. Live would be everything.
Tens of millions of records after. The song remains the same, but the singer has become far more elusive.
The vocals.
In a Tokyo hotel room, I still can't quite believe that of all the world's press, Michael's agreed to talk to me again. His first major TV interview this decade.
I'm glad to see you again. Thanks.
But you don't get this deep inside the fortress without conditions. Strict limits on time, even the number of questions. I took Michael back to our interview all those years ago.
You had a lot of aspirations at that time, a lot of dreams. Would it be fair to say that a lot of those dreams over the last 10 years, because it was in 1977 that interview, have come true for you?
Most of my dreams seem to come true, and I'm so thankful that they do. I don't know over what period of time, but I have lots of dreams and they usually come true, and I'm so glad.
Wow.
Fans on a warm September night watch Michael set music alight.
Tonight, it's Tokyo.
An inkling of things to come when his Magical Mystery World Tour hits Australia in November.
Okay, so if you guys didn't know, he launched the Bad Tour in Japan. So one of the first stops. So really cool that he invited an Australian reporter to this to do press. Very interesting.
Even if his music is not your style, few can resist the Lord of the Dance.
I'm just loving this footage.
I always loved to dance. When I was just real little, I used to watch Sammy Davis, Fred Astaire, and James Brown, and just dancing about the house. So I don't remember not dancing.
My bad era people are like in heaven right now because this is like optimal. Oh, it's just amazing. Optimal footage, optimal audio, like
superstars. Michael has to deal with a plague of allegations about his private life. Headlines which paint him as a weird recluse. Rumors about his supposedly mammoth plastic surgery. About his supposed fascination for bizarre relics like the elephant man. How much of it is true? Ask the question, and you meet Michael's manager, cigar-smoking Frank DeLeo. He joined the interview as Michael's friend and chief minder. Now, about those headlines.
Does it affect you? Does it hurt you to see some idiotic stories that are written?
Yeah, I'll answer that question if you don't mind. It hurts me. And if it hurts me, I know it hurts Michael. He's a little more blasé about it than I am. He just sort of shrugs it off. But I find it very terrible that some of the stuff that is written, particularly about plastic surgery, and the majority of it, not the majority, all of it is garbage and rubbish. And, you know, if that's the best thing, that that's the only thing they can figure out to do with their life, then, you know, they're pretty sick people.
Avoiding the spotlight off stage for this most wanted star requires some extraordinary escape routes. And in talking to us, Michael at least confirms one of those myths, that he dons disguises to slip unseen into the real world.
I like to sneak into theaters without being noticed sometimes. Sometimes there's really nothing you can do about it. It's the price you have to pay.
Well, I've heard sometimes you turn up in the most unexpected places to your friends dressed in, but they don't even recognize you.
I have incredible disguises. I can fool my own mother.
Wow.
I enjoy doing it because I get to see life the way it really is sometimes, which is fun.
But when Michael does step out as himself, it's an event. While in Tokyo, we were lucky enough to catch a rare glimpse of Michael's home video, showing a Jackson shopping spree. Together with a few select friends, Michael has a huge department store to himself.
It's the same as our local hotel. It's not the same as
When you're locked inside the four walls of fame and looking out at the crush of fans looking in, there's nothing quite as precious as one true friend. In Michael's case, that friend is Quincy Jones. They met on the film set of The Wiz.
I met Michael at Sammy Davis's house when he was about 12. And you just, you know, you just fall in love with Michael at any age. And The Wiz was when we really connected.
Interesting.
He was a scarecrow, and he'd pull out bits of paper, quotes from Confucius, etc., all these great philosophers. And one time he says, blah, 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 sign, Socrates. And he kept saying, Socrates, 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 and nobody would correct him. And after a while, I took him over to the side and said, Michael, forgive me, if you know, but it's Socrates, you know. And at that moment, our eyes met. And something happened that's never changed since then.
Quincy Jones has produced Michael's three major solo records, including pop's biggest selling album of all time, Thriller.
Something about this beat always gets to me. I just like want to start dancing right now.
Like, did you check up on sales each week and realize that it was doing this?
I pretty much did the album and just sat back and watched because it was another one of my dreams. I knew it was going to do what it did.
Selling over 40 million copies, Thriller not only changed the way music was made, but also video clips. But perhaps one of Michael's greatest influences has been on dance. He took breakdancing out of New York's ghettos and made it a passion for his generation.
Did that amuse you that people were, or did it flatter you that people were trying to do your dance steps? And
I always love watching that, especially the children when they wear all the gear and everything and imitate me. I think it's fun. Stunning good taste is fun.
Help me.
Everything from the Frank Sinatra to the Fred Astaire of the 80s. The spotlight has made him music's first billionaire. All that at 29.
He's like a laser beam all the time. He always does his homework. I've never ever seen him nervous about anything. I called him just before he went on this show. This is his first solo tour ever. I said, you nervous? He said, no, I can't wait to get on stage tonight.
Clichés seem to fall away when you watch Michael perform. When he says he's inspired by things spiritual, you believe him. And when he says that four-letter word love, you believe that too.
Yeah, I love children and animals and Quincy and Frank. But that's what's so wonderful about traveling. I get to see all the cultures and people and the children. It's wonderful. It's my greatest inspiration, I would say.
It was that sense of humanity that inspired Michael to sit down with Lionel Richie in the summer of 85 and write this. I was lucky enough to be at the recording of We Are The World. And even amongst the greatest collection of superstars ever gathered, all eyes were on Michael, the pitch-perfect performer who seemed to be singing out a dream.
I said I wanted it to be something like an anthem where it would affect the whole world, you know, where everybody could sing it and have such melodic simplicity to it. Where a five-year-old child could sing it and like it, that type of thing. And as I remember waking up from my sleep the next morning, before putting it down, really, most of the song was there. And I went in the studio and kind of did a demo and presented it. And first Quincy asked me to do it with Lionel, you know. And I remember calling Quincy telling him I had the tape, and then Lionel put some lyric to it, and I hate saying who did what, but it always sounds so...
something of interest, though.
But just when you thought it was safe to call Michael Pop's good boy, he comes up with this.
You booked a sunny Verbo ski chalet with endless views of snow-covered peaks, but the thing you'll remember...
The squeaky clean superstar who takes his rock and roll without the sex and drugs has called his latest album Bad. In a world where he could have cashed in on his fame overnight, Michael spent 6 years making Bad sound exceptionally good. I asked him why.
Oh boy, that's a hard question.
Well, first of all, you wrote 9 of the songs on this album.
Yeah. It's just a series of collecting songs and writing songs in my mind over a period of years or whatever. And it's hard to say how one creates music because it's hard for me to take credit. I feel it's more spiritual and heavenly than I can't take credit for it. Really. Right.
My Window, my favorite song.
The Peter Pan figure bathed in blue light. Michael Jackson is truly one of modern music's enigmas. Some say he's a kid who never really grew up. But perhaps his friend Steven Spielberg had it right when he said, "It's a nice place Michael comes from. I wish we could all spend some time in his world."
Yeah, seriously.
Tell him that is human nature. Why? Why does he do me that way?
If you're given one wish now, what would you like?
One wish?
Yeah. I was going to say the fairy godmother, but I won't say that. If I could give you a wish, is there anything you wish for?
There's so many I have, but one of the main ones, would be as simple as making the whole world happy and world peace, and that is part of the reason why I do what I do.
Thank you. guys. So let's just chat about what we just saw. That was really a great interview. I have never seen it before. I have to admit, honestly, though, my favorite part of this entire 60-minute segment was honestly the bad tour footage. Michael Jackson bad tour footage, especially footage in that red shirt, is so hard to come by that I was just like, in the moment, seriously, with that. I did not know until watching this that Frank DeLeo was sitting right next to him during this interview, kind of just like making sure the questions were appropriate. Of course, they explained that Michael had a set list of questions and time constraints and all of that, and which is to be expected, right? I mean, Michael Jackson had to be very cautious, especially in those days when the bad press kind of started. And I won't even say bad press, but just like kind of like hater stuff, you know? People saying things about Michael Jackson, like he was a recluse, he was private, he was this, he was that. It started way earlier than the early 90s, as we could see. It started, I think, around the Thriller era is what I've heard. And then Bad era things, you know, his popularity just heightened even more so from there. But I really loved this interview. One of the things that I was really touched by was the fact that Michael said that he had dreams and they usually come true. And it really made me feel just so emotional in that moment, because I felt like, wow, like imagine kind of like having these dreams and these aspirations and thinking about all the things that you'd like to see in your life and your career, and they actually happen and come true. Like, what is that, you know? And so it's really just a blessing, and a blessing to be able to see like Michael Jackson's career and the way that it blossomed and the things he was able to achieve, all from his dreams, and not only his dreams though, but his hard work. Michael Jackson's also super duper humble. So, you know, he's not gonna say, hey, you know, I was practicing for hours and hours and hours until I pass out, you know? I think Kobe Bryant told that story, that Michael Jackson said that he literally dances till his legs cannot anymore, till he physically cannot. So, and he said that like really like helped him realize, okay, I gotta step up my game and my work ethic. Like, Michael Jackson is it in terms of focus and drive and also dreaming. It takes a lot to be able to come up with amazing music, also the dance moves, but also just to have that stage presence and that passion. And I think that's why a lot of people love the Bad Tour and love to watch Bad Tour footage and just time footage from him from around that time, because he's just so passionate and you can see he's just like fully like into his solo career. Although that being said, watching the Bad Tour intro footage, you see that it's very similar to the History Tour introductory footage. If you've seen the History Tour, you'll know that the Jacksons kind of come down steps one by one. And here they're coming up steps. He's coming up steps with the background dancers, but very, very similar intro. So I thought it was really cool, you know, that although it was a show with him and his brothers, he was still a solo artist during the Victory Tour. Thriller album had came out, and so it's cool to see him take some of those elements and implement them into the Bad Tour, especially for people that did not get to see it, because the Victory Tour did not go to all these countries like the Bad Tour did. So, really cool interview. I also noticed that Michael did not take his glasses off at all, which is not surprising, but it also made me kind of like want more and kind of heightened the mystery for me. So I was kind of like, okay, what is he looking like behind those glasses? Like, what are his eyes saying, you know? Because literally looking through the windows, the window to your heart, your eyes, you know, your eyes tell a lot. And Michael Jackson is pretty expressive. So to see him do that whole interview behind sunglasses, I was kind of like, I wish I knew what his facial expressions were saying right now. But yeah, I really enjoyed that Molly Meldrum interview. Comment down below and let me know, you guys, did you guys enjoy this 60-minute segment? Is this the first time that you guys have watched it? And if there are any other interviews that you'd like to see me react to, let me know. We do all Michael Jackson videos around here, so anything Michael Jackson, Jackson 5, or Jackson family related is game. All right, you guys, I hope you enjoyed this video, and I will see you guys next time. Bye.